Roughly 100 billion tons of cellulosic sugars are produced by photosynthesis today, annually, which is about 20 times more than the production, upstream production of crude oil. So, you know, these types of biocellulosic sugars are available. And it's due to this sort of global abundance that we believe that these waste-based biomass streams, you know, from sugars and others, biofuels, offer a competitive alternative to other net zero fuels.
Hello, you're watching Proactive. Joining me is Quadrise Chief Technology Officer, Jason Miles. Jason, very good to speak with you. Could you talk us through your recent announcement and the significance of Alder Renewables as a joint development partner?
Yeah, sure, Stephen. It's a pleasure to be back. So, Alder Renewables, they're a US-based biofuel technology company. They're backed by major, some other major companies such as Honeywell, United Airlines Ventures, and Boeing. They have a fast pyrolysis technology platform that transforms sustainable biomass into sort of biocrudes and sugars. And these products are candidates for both the aviation sector and marine sector, respectively. So the Alder process produces a pyrolysis sugar that's basically a water-soluble product. And these can potentially be used and incorporated in our bioMSAR technology platform alongside glycerin and other biogenic energy sources, hence the interest. So the JDA that we announced recently focuses on sort of continuing the lab work that we already started at QRF and scaling this up to a range of engine testing and approvals, which starts a small scale there and come in test. So far the results to date at QRF have been very promising, albeit we're at the start of it, obviously a 12-month program, so more to come. And really, I guess the basis behind the JDA with Alder also, you know, the benefit is it also increases our North American presence and opens up opportunities to work with major universities and testing partners, including the US EPA, as an example.
Jason, what are the main drivers for the use of bioMSAR by existing and future clients of Quadrise, such as marine?
Our bioMSAR product is slightly different to our conventional MSAR fuel, as it contains sustainable biofuel components, which reduce the carbon intensity of the fuel, depending on how much we blend. But otherwise, the properties and performance of both fuels are quite similar. Our standard bioMSAR is comparable with B24 or B30 or other fuels that are used in the marine sector. And our new bioMSAR Zero product is comparable with something called a B100 biofuel, as it contains basically 100% biogenic feedstock as the energy source. So the main drivers really for the use of biofuels such as ours in the marine sector are both regulatory and voluntary. So the regulations that are in place today are designed to reduce sort of marine CO2 emissions. These have commenced already in European waters under the Fit for 55 initiative, which is well underway. But shippers are also having to increasingly being encouraged and incentivized both by the IMO in terms of future regulations, but also by their major customers such as IKEA, Amazon, and electric car producers as well, to reduce the carbon intensity of their journeys. So the main attraction, going back to your original question, is really of bioMSAR, is that it's blended to offer a tangible energy cost saving over equivalent biofuel. So it's designed to be cheaper, frankly, than the alternatives. But it's also then more efficient to use in a diesel engine, especially, which saves money and it produces fewer emissions, including both NOx, particulates, and importantly, CO2. So, you know, as we approach these sort of EU and IMO 2030 checkpoints, what we're seeing, quite frankly, is in the need to really secure immediate emissions reductions from vessel operators, in order for them to remain compliant. And it's placing a lot of pressure on the owners and operators. This really makes the use of technology such as ours with bioMSAR a vital tool in securing emissions reductions in a cost-effective way. As the viability of obviously other lower carbon fuel technologies continues to develop.
One of the concerns of biofuels used by the maritime sector for the next 25 years is feedstock availability and price. What's your view on this, Jason?
Yeah, well, you raise an important point. A recent study by Transport and Environment, which is a well-known body in the marine sector, it indicates that biofuels can make up a third of the global fuel mix by 2030, based on quite aggressive targets set by EU and Japan. waste-based biofuels, which are used today, such as cooking oils and animal fats or agricultural residues, they're preferred due to the low environmental impact, but their availability is limited, and it cannot really meet this projected demand, which today is well over 250 million tonnes a year of fuel oil equivalent. So there's a risk. There's also a risk for shipping that, you know, the feedstocks that I mentioned will be diverted to the transportation and aviation sectors, where the mandates for the biofuel use and the fuel prices are high, frankly, so they can pay more. The alternative, the shipping sector, is then crop-based biofuels, which could be, you know, used extensively by shipping, but they would require quite a large landmass to do that. You know, the estimates by T&E are that 35 million hectares would be required by 2030, which is an area the size of Germany. So it's quite a considerable new landmass that's required to generate these types of biofuels. So where we are looking is, you know, waste-based biomass. These are sort of viewed as the most abundant sources of biofuel for marine. And in the context of bioMSAR, the data we've seen and shared with others through Fotoro and other outlets and other partners is that roughly 100 billion tonnes of cellulosic sugars are produced by photosynthesis today annually, which is about 20 times more than the upstream production of crude oil. So, you know, these types of biocellulosic sugars are available. And it's due to this sort of global abundance that we believe that these waste-based biomass streams, from sugars and other biofuels, offer a competitive alternative to other net zero fuels, such as green ammonia and methanol. As a route to market is simpler, the infrastructure investment is much less, and it's much simpler to accommodate. So that's really where we sit in this at the moment. We expect, because of the abundance, the price will be competitive as well.
Jason, what's next on the radar with regards to commercial use of bioMSAR and widening the product offering to customers around the world?
So the next important milestone for bioMSAR is obviously the commercial container vessel trial that involves both MSC and Cargill, as well as other industry stakeholders. So we expect this trial will commence later in Q3 if the bilateral agreements are signed soon. And to prepare for scale-up of the bioMSAR business, we are discussing opportunities with various parties globally to install modular quadrised multi-fuel manufacturing units, MMUs, to other bunker hubs as well, which is linked to expected demand for the products. And we are also commencing an RDI program to focus on the treatment of residual glycerin and other methyl ester residual products to ensure the availability of sort of low-cost bioMSAR feedstock in the future. One other aspect we're looking at is, together with Vitoro, we're planning a bioMSAR zero trial using their crude sugar oil product in our bioMSAR platform, and that'll be used on a focused motor yacht later in the year, is what we're planning. And then finally, we'll continue our JDA activities with Alder Renewables and others previously announced to advance the use of sustainable biomass products and sugars for the marine sector, because we believe this is a really a competitive future fuel solution and platform for the existing shipping fleet to comply with regulatory and customer-led pressures. And frankly, not every ship owner is willing to invest in a brand new dual fuel vessel at the moment because of so many other constraints and uncertainties in the world. So it is an exciting time for the shipping sector. And frankly, Quadrise team are scaling up to be an important player in the decarbonisation journey.
Jason, I hope you'll continue to keep us updated on your progress. Thank you very much for speaking with us today.
Thanks very much, Stephen.
That's Jason Miles, Chief Technology Officer at Quadrise.